Hello and welcome. Thanks for joining us for House Calls Now, a special edition of House Calls, Real Docs, Real Talk. I'm your host, Mercedes Fuller. It seems like every day there's breaking news on COVID-19. Variants of the disease continue to pop up, and this is very alarming. And the guidance about the different vaccines can be so confusing. Do we need booster shots or don't we? Dozens of headlines have been discussing these particular issues, so we decided to discuss them right here. House Calls Now is designed to give you the latest news as it's happening. With me today is Dr. Camilla Sasson, our friend, Vice President of Healthcare Business Solutions Science and Innovation right here at the American Heart Association. Dr. Sasson, welcome back, and it's great to see you.
Thanks for having me. Great questions, by the way.
Absolutely. Let's get right into these questions in our segment that we call You Ask, We Answer. Our first question comes to us from Marissa in West Virginia. She's wondering, what are the new variants that are showing up and should I be worried about them?
Well, you know, I think the one that most people are probably hearing the most about right now is the Delta variant. And that's the one that had started in India actually in December of 2020 and has made its way literally all over the world and is now our predominant strain here in the US. I think for me as a doc, what's most alarming is that about a month ago, only about 20% of our cases were Delta. Now over 80% of them are the Delta variant. So we know it's much more transmissible, probably about the same virulence, meaning that in terms of getting people sick, but it's out there and it's spreading like wildfire. And that, I think, as an ER doc has been the hardest thing for me because I kind of felt like we were done or we were kind of on cruising, you know, cruise mode. And it's a little scary now. But I think we've, you know, as long as people are getting vaccinated, I think we're seeing at least the vast majority of folks being hospitalized are the ones who are not vaccinated. So our vaccines are still doing really well against that Delta variant. There is one other variant too that's out there, which is the Lambda, kind of making its way up from South America right now. One case so far that we've heard about in Texas, at least, that's made the news. But that's another one that we're kind of watching as well.
Absolutely. Speaking of the variants, this question comes to us from Dora in Baton Rouge, and she wants to know, are the new variants more transmissible?
That is a great question. They are very much more transmissible. So we kind of thought when the original coronavirus started that about one person could infect about 2.5 people or so. What we know with the Delta variant is that one person now can infect anywhere from 4 to 6 people, depending on kind of which studies you're looking at. So a lot easier to transmit, a lot easier to catch. Again, we know that people who are vaccinated can still catch the coronavirus, but they're less likely to get the disease, which is actually COVID-19, and to become symptomatic from it. But again, it just means it's going to be so much more important for people to get vaccinated because, quite honestly, this weekend I worked in the ER and the people who were getting admitted to the hospital were all the ones who were not vaccinated. And it's scary how quickly this is kind of, those numbers are going up again.
Absolutely. Here's one from Peter in Savannah, Georgia. He's wondering, were the vaccines tested properly?
I get this question a lot, as you can imagine. And all I can say is unequivocally, yes, they absolutely have been tested. So they follow the exact same process that all of our vaccines have done in the past. But normally those take 10 to 15 years to come to market, if you will. What's different? We're in the middle of a global pandemic. What does that mean? We got rid of a lot of the bureaucracy and the administrative issues. We got a lot more collaboration globally. So everybody's focused on getting that COVID vaccine out. And then we've also gotten really much of the testing that has been done usually happens sort of sequentially. We've been able to do it much more rapidly, still doing all the same testing that we would normally do, just speeding up that timeline because quite honestly, we have to. We're in the middle of a pandemic.
Doc, I know that you have two little kiddos at home and Derek is wondering about the kids. Are these vaccines safe for kids?
Oh gosh, you know, Mercedes, I wish my kiddos could get the vaccine. They're only 4 and 6. So right now there is an EUA, emergency use authorization, that is in place for kids who are 12 years and older. So any kid who's 12 years and up is eligible to get that vaccine. So the clinical trials are happening right now for kids under 12, but they are absolutely safe. And they're going to be the best defense that we have in terms of keeping our kids healthy and keeping our schools open.
Yeah, absolutely. We want to make sure our kids can go back to school in August. I'm a former school teacher, so that's important. We want to see the kids back in school. Here's one from Anna in Carlsbad. Can a vaccine affect my child's or my own future fertility?
So I had to do a little bit of digging to even figure out where in the world this came from. So first of all, no, there is no impact of the vaccine on your fertility. So there's something that went around, some rumor that went around saying that basically there's a protein in the vaccine that potentially could cause you to have your placenta not attached to the uterus. So that actually doesn't even mean you can't get pregnant. That's what infertility means. What we know is that you can get pregnant. We actually are also very much telling all of our pregnant women to get the vaccine because they're at such a high risk for getting COVID-19 and being severely ill and even being hospitalized with it. So absolutely no truth to that rumor whatsoever. I want to make sure I get that across. No, it does not affect your fertility.
Thank you for clearing that up for us. Here's one from George in Wisconsin. He's wondering, do the vaccines cause long-term harm?
No, this is, again, what they cause is long-term life. They don't cause long-term harm. They make sure that if you do even get exposed to somebody with the coronavirus, that you are pretty much unlikely to get sick and very unlikely to be hospitalized or to even die from COVID-19. So what do vaccines do? They save lives. They don't cause harm. They don't, you know, you may have some side effects, of course, when you do get the vaccine, but those are usually very mild. But at the end of the day, it's our best defense against coronavirus.
Absolutely. Teresa wants to know, I've heard some cases of younger adults getting myocarditis after their vaccine. What is this and what should I look for to know if my child has this?
That's a great question. So there are a few reports of people, especially young people, the case reports are actually in 16-year-old males, primarily or adolescent males, after their second dose, in which the CDC saw some cases of myocarditis. Now, again, in terms of actually the number of people who've gotten the vaccine and the number of these reported cases, again, very, very rare complication from it. But if you were to go home and want to look for any signs for that, you would just be looking for something around, you know, chest pain maybe, or having a lot more difficulty breathing, maybe feeling more fatigued. Those are kind of vague complaints again. So you have to sort of be on the lookout for it, which is why the CDC right away put out that warning to make sure that everybody was, you know, really aware of what was potential could happen. But at the end of the day, you know, again, a very rare complication of, again, the Pfizer or the Moderna vaccine is where they've seen it.
We're getting a lot of parents sending in questions, Doc. And Erica is asking a very good question that I've heard a number of times. Is there anything that I can do to protect my younger child who is not yet eligible for a vaccine?
Oh, I hear you. Believe me, I have a 4 and a 6-year-old at home and I ask myself the question every day. So what you can do, number one, again, is be vaccinated. Everybody that is in your social circle that is going to see your kids should also get vaccinated as well. And then, you know, the thing that we're starting to think about too is when you're going to indoor spaces, especially those that have poor ventilation, or if you're going to crowded outdoor spaces, wear the mask. The mask actually can help tremendously in terms of decreasing your risk of getting an airborne virus like coronavirus. And then, of course, just all the other preventative things that we know really help. So keeping that social distance, making sure you're in a good ventilation spot, get tested right away if you think that you might have some symptoms or your child might have some symptoms. And then that contact tracing is going to be really important too. So really just being aware of your surroundings and just knowing that, you know, our kids are not eligible right now. So we're going to be the people that have to protect them.
Here's another one. Juanita is asking us this. Do I need a booster shot if I have been fully vaccinated?
Well, the White House response team and Dr. Fauci even just today reiterated that at this time, they do not think, based on the data that they've seen, that people need booster shots. So right now, the answer is no. But as we know with this pandemic, we are flying the plane as we're going. And so the conditions may change again, right? That Delta variant may become different, or we may have the next mutation that comes along. So for now, the recommendations are still that no boosters are needed. But just, I think people need to be aware that the conditions, just like when you're flying on a plane, the conditions can change rapidly. So just being aware of that and knowing that the answer today is a booster, but that could be different in a week or 2 weeks or even a month from now, potentially.
How about this question from yours truly? Dr. Sasson, what are your thoughts about the new guidance from the American Academy of Pediatrics? Just last week, they issued a statement about children and adults wearing face masks in schools. Can you talk us through this?
So they, you know, came out really ahead of the CDC and even some of the other school districts out there and said, look, we know that based on studies from this last year in Massachusetts, when people were universally masking, meaning that no matter what their vaccination status was, everybody wore a mask, everyone did 3 feet of social distancing, what they found was very few outbreaks in those classrooms. And so, you know, I think they came out ahead of the pack and said, look, in order to keep our doors open, let's keep all of our kids and staff masked, regardless of age, regardless of vaccination status, and keep those preventative layered measures in place. And I think, you know, again, they made a bold statement. It's, you know, a little bit controversial right now, but I'll be honest, as a parent, I'm going to send my kiddos back to school with masks on because, again, the biggest thing I want for my kids is that they are not at home with me, Mercedes. I want them back at school. I want them learning in person. And I don't want those classrooms to close.
Absolutely. I think we caught that. You want the kiddos back at school, and there's nothing wrong with that. And I want the kiddos back at school, too. A former school teacher, I believe in the power of that seat in the classroom. Dr. Sasson, thank you so much for helping us make sense of the headlines. The science is changing every day, and I hope that today we've eased a few minds. Is there anything else that you'd like to add before we sign off?
I just want to remind everybody that the best thing you guys can do is make sure that you and every other person who's eligible for a vaccine gets vaccinated. So now more than ever, it's going to be so important, especially with that Delta variant. And thank you for helping us really dispel any myths that people have, and always available to answer questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sasson. Always good to see you. Thank you for joining us once again. This has been House Calls Now. Take care and we'll see you soon.
Learn more about House Calls, Real Docs, Real Talk, and submit your questions at heart.org/housecalls.